way you'll never fall in love.
1985, Bobby Longbottom, who directed the original production of Sideshow, told me that a friend of his had seen this terrible movie called Chained for Life at 4 a.m. on television in Chicago, and it starred these real-life conjoined twins who sang and danced and played musical instruments.
My boyfriend at the time and I were on the road in 42nd Street, tap dancing for a living, and I've always, you know, had a quest for the queer, loved all of John Waters' movies, and he stumbled upon this at like 3 a.m. He taped it for me and he said, you've got to see this movie.
The Hilton sisters were conjoined twins who were born in Brighton, England in 1908, and they went on to become the highest paid act in the history of vaudeville.
Chained for Life was essentially an exploitation film, you know, because they had been in Freaks, Todd Browning's Freaks, years ago when they were really young girls. I'm guessing they were late 40s, and they certainly weren't moving around with these anymore. We hear they were bagging groceries for a living. Can you imagine? And so it was sad. It was sad. They didn't have that vitality that you can see in the earlier pictures of them.
Oh, it's just terrible. One of them has a romance, and the other one doesn't like him and ends up shooting him, and then they're on trial and they decide they can't condemn the one because the other would be condemned to jail too. It's pretty cheesy.
If you really want to get depressed, if you're feeling much too happy,
right,
get a hold of it and watch it.
Right, it's really bad.
They did a dream ballet, which was ridiculous, but upon the second viewing of it, I started to feel something. I started to get it and understood, wow, what a thing to have to make peace with, you know? And the freak or the thing in all of us that can't be medicated, can't be removed, has to be lived with. What a great metaphor.
And Bobby said, I think we should do a musical about them. And I immediately said, that is a great idea. I just thought the possibilities of two actors singing together and moving together was so interesting.
New York Public Library, spent a lot of time there. I got everything that I could get my hands on. The costume designer originally, Greg Barnes, a dear friend, he had a friend who knew somebody that had been their manager. And he had this trove of pictures that had been taken and blown up. So he said, well, this man, Bobby, should have them. So he sent them to me. That was very informative.
We really didn't begin writing Sideshow until 7 years later. But in the interim, a friend of mine found this booklet, which had been produced in connection with Chained for Life, this terrible movie. And it was their purported autobiography. And it was written in alternating paragraphs that went, I, Daisy, am exuberant and outgoing. And then the next paragraph.
Violet.
Yeah, I, Violet, am shy and retiring. And we were able to sort of verify that most of the major events in this little booklet were real. But there was a lot of, you know, hype always about them. So you didn't know what exactly was true and what wasn't. But that just spoke to me. That booklet just spoke to me emotionally about their lives. And it was the major source we used when shaping the original production.
I'm Daisy. I'm Violet. We're Siamese twins. I'm to your right as you watch our show.
She thinks she's always right.
Not so. I'm Daisy. I'm Violet. What else would you like to know?
In 1992, our show pageant was up and running off Broadway, and Bobby said, well, what's next? How about those twins? And I said, let's do it.
And then we thought, who should write the music? Whose show do we love more than any? For me, it was Dreamgirls. It was Dreamgirls. I'd never met Henry before, but I was crazy for that score. So we reached out to him.
I got a fax, and it said, introduced Bill and Bobby to me, and said, we have a new project and we want you to do it with us. We only want you. Can we meet? So I figured, sure.
He replied back very soon and drank the Kool-Aid, so to speak, and we started the journey.
Certainly wasn't the kind of musical that I had expected. Chained for Life developing into a musical was not something I had anticipated, but I was taken with their spirit and their enthusiasm and their conceptions of what it could be.
After we met Henry in 1992, that process started. And it was quite a while later before we did the first reading. The show was then called Songs of the Siamese Twins. Bill came up with Sideshow, which was a vast improvement, I think.
And we started just writing songs that seemed like moments in their lives that could sing. We wrote a ton of material that never made it into the show. My husband, Bruce, put together a CD of songs cut from Sideshow, and that is 90 minutes long and doesn't even have all of the stuff we wrote.
I think our first reading, we did have a different Daisy and Violet. I mean, we were at the place, we just wanted to hear it, and we didn't have auditions for that. We cast friends and people who were recommended, but then we did start auditioning, and we saw many, many people.
I just auditioned for a reading. I hear it's about Siamese twins. What's that? Could be interesting, you know. But, you know, anytime you get to audition for a new musical, there's always the potential of, oh, this could be an interesting thing. Could be a piece of crap, could be interesting. You know, it's a crapshoot.
Emily was just astonishing.
She sang Sisters, and it was so appropriate. It was just the greatest choice of material. She just was fantastic.
Her ability to move you and to weep when she sings and, you know, to play this broken girl and yet be strong and, yeah, we all fell in love with her deeply, and I think her talent informed a lot of this role.
Over the next few readings, we paired her with other people that were very good, but it just didn't quite, the pairing didn't work for one reason or another.
We had a number of violets along the way, and I think one of those reasons is the character wasn't as defined. Daisy is the lead. She was the aggressive one. She made the decisions. She probably had the stronger heart physically. And it took us a while to find the right complement to Emily.
They had me come in and they paired me with a couple of different people, and then Alice came in and it was like, oh, wow, that's something.
I saw her in Sunset Boulevard and I loved her in that. And she came in and auditioned.
I can first remember seeing Alice on stage, and it was in Tommy, and she was on for Mrs. Walker. And I remember at that time going, this is so interesting. This girl reminds me of me, even then, which is a little surreal to sort of think about in retrospect.
I got a call from my agent. The week previous, he had called me for an audition for a show called The 10,000 or 1,000 Fingers or Toes of Dr. T. What is that musical? Remember when that was making the rounds? And I thought, that's kind of an unusual title. And then a week later, I got a call for this show called Sideshow, which was about, they still called it Siamese Twins back then. And he said, you know, there's the show, Sideshow, do you want to audition? And I thought, it's an interesting subject for a musical.
Everybody then learned the music, so she sang back to us, Who Will Love Me As I Am. And then we put the two of them together. I was adamant that they'd be the same height, shoulders, breasts, hip, everything line up. And they did. They actually did.
Not only were we sort of physically right together, but there was a strength. There was an equally matched strength of persona and performer there, which was interesting immediately.
So, there was something about when Emily and I literally put our hips up against each other, something happened. It's hard to put into words.
And they learned I Will Never Leave You and Who Will Love Me As I Am. And we were just, I mean, it just completely knocked us out.
I was very lifted by it. And I said, this is going to work, you know.
Sweet girl.
remember thinking, how am I going to relate to this character because she's a Siamese twin? There was no precedent. I don't remember a musical about Siamese twins before this or ever having met one. But once I got into the rehearsals and I started to discover Violet, I realized that I'm just like her. I'm no different from her at all, except I'm not attached to some lady who's my sister.
Krieger invited me to a presentation. And out of respect, I went, because Henry is a good guy. And on the chair of that presentation, it described that it was about Siamese twins, and I said, what the hell am I doing here? Are you crazy? And then they played the music and told the story, and it was seductive.
We got such aggressively positive feedback from that I think everybody knew this was going to be something.
We all fell in love with what it was about and the music that he wrote.
He brought other people in who would end up producing with him.
Right.
They were pretty taciturn businessmen when they walked in, and they were blubbering on the way out, so we knew we had moved them a lot.
I was living in LA. I came back. Vinnie Lift, the casting director, brought me right into we did a workshop of it, and it was a very happy accident that I had just returned at that point, and he seemed to think I was the right guy. So we did the workshop. It was a huge success. And then I got a job. I went out of town, and they needed to do another reading, and so Chris Invar did it. And so then I had to sweat bullets while they decided whether to use me or Chris for the final, for the big workshop that happened before Broadway.
It was one of those dream workshops. I'd only seen this happen once or twice, both with Tommy Tune. With Grand Hotel in 9, he somehow, because there was nothing playing in what was then the 46th Street Theater, before it became the Richard Rogers, he was able to use that space to set those two shows. He even had a couch for himself to lay on in the front row. But I went into that and go, wow, what a thing to be able to go up to the balcony and look at your show in the space that it might play, or a proper theater. And Manny Azenberg found the Rogers and said, this is where we're going to do our workshop. 6 weeks we spent in the theater. So we lived there. We'd have rehearsals down in the ladies' bathroom. We'd be all over the place. And Henry would take naps up in the box, house right. And we did 3 or 4 performances of it. And the word went out after that. It was, everybody was dressed basically in black. There were some props. And in some ways, that was my favorite version of the show.
We did the workshop production, and we're waiting to see if that was going to actually come make a production happen to fruition. And I was doing Jekyll and Hyde at the time, and then I got word that, yes, we were going to get a production of it. So I only did Jekyll and Hyde for the first 6 months of the run, and then I left to do Sideshow.
The very first time I ever heard about Sideshow was 1996. And I was still doing Miss Saigon, and there was a workshop that was being messed around with, and I had to go in for a call. And they liked what I did, but my results were basically I was too leading man. So I went to see the workshop when the public was allowed to see it, and I loved it. Just fell in love with the show, and I know who they chose, and I was very happy about that. And he did a great job and everything. God rest his soul, James Stovall. But then a year later, they decided to have another audition. And my agent said, well, go in looking as scruffly or raggedy as you can. So I didn't shave for like 2 days. I wore a shirt inside out.
Norm Lewis came in and auditioned, and I was in the office. And Henry Krieger called and said, I think you should come down and hear this.
I had just booked a commercial and was getting ready to fly down to, I think Miami, to shoot this commercial. So I had to postpone that. So I had brought my suitcase and everything with me.
He sang, and he just knocked everybody out. So I said, why don't you offer him the job? Don't call the agent. Don't wait 2 weeks. Don't go through that process. Just walk up to him and say, how would you like to play the part?
And said, are you offering that to me? And they said, yeah. So I kind of said, can you hold on just 1 second? And I went by the window that was in that audition room and just started crying.
Tears just rolled down.
I just broke down in joyous crying. I did Miss Saigon 6 months in Toronto and 2 years on Broadway, and by the end of my run there, I ended up getting my real estate license, so I started doing real estate for a while. But then this came up, and I was so glad to have something new to do.
I'm not gonna lie, it was a dark time. I was getting divorced. My agency was folding because my agent's partner was caught embezzling, and I didn't want to audition because I needed some downtime. So kind of like a rebellious teenager, I didn't shower. I threw on like nasty looking clothes. I didn't comb my hair. I mean, I went in, I looked like a hobo. On opening, Alice Ripley gave me a little stuffed zebra, and his name is Zippy, and he's got like hair that goes like in every direction, because that's how I walked into my audition, with like bedhead basically.
Robin Wagner has became my mentor and one of my best friends. I mean, he changed musical theater with Chorus Line at 42nd Street and Dreamgirls, so we connected immediately. And, you know, Robin's motto is, what can we take away? What don't we need? Apparently, in the very early days of Chorus Line, Morales did, you know, there was a toboggan on stage. There was a lot of literal representations of things. And Robin and I agreed immediately, we didn't need that. Our set piece was Emily and Alice. When they joined together, nothing could or should get in the way of that.
I think I have this idea that the ensemble would start as audience members at the sideshow. And so we had this set of bleachers, which became the set throughout the show in different configurations. And the cast entered, and they were dressed like regular people from the 30s. And they just sat there and stared at the audience. So there were the two audiences staring at each other. And then the music started, and they started to sing. And as the boss stood up and described the attractions, they suggested them theatrically.
And so the bleachers were born. We both thought, what a great form. We're mimicking the audience. We're mimicking something that is a staple in carnivals and freak shows. And I quickly realized they could be put into 21 configurations and represent walls and other staircases and barriers. That was, you know, fantastic. That's Robin.
We talked about the physical production, and he said, well, how do you see these actors working? And we said, well, they'll be, you know, sewn together in corsets. And he said, no, I think that would be kind of grotesque. I think the audience should make the connection with their imagination.
Since we weren't doing any prosthetics, our whole vocabulary was, you and the audience keep those girls together by them putting their hips together. You and the audience see, you know, the geek, and but you also imagine, maybe it looks like me a little bit. You know, I mean, that was a deliberate choice of mine to insist that the audience be confronted with that truth.
That sort of became the shaping principle of that production, of letting the audience's imagination fill in the blanks, and it was very, very powerful, very stark, and very striking.
You know, we flipped the girls. Actually, you know, they were on the other side in real life, and for a number of reasons. The most important one, that I'm Daisy, I'm Violet, sang better than I'm Violet, I'm Daisy. And since Emily was the stronger character, I liked her stage right, so.
During the workshop, I know, we rehearsed with Greg made us a corset, double corset, and we wrapped it around both of us and tied it up and rehearsed that way for 6 and 8 hours at a time, day after day.
And I'd go home and I'd sort of feel lonely. Like, I remember feeling, oh, this was weird to not, you know, I'd be going like this in bed, going, she's not there, it's weird.
But that was just as an exercise for rehearsal. By the time we got to, you know, to the performances, we were never attached.
I thought that was the least difficult part of Sideshow. That was sort of there from the beginning.
Bless their hearts. I mean, they did it. Those two girls aren't proper dancers. That Egyptian number, they were dancing, and they stay together. It's hard, especially if you lead with your right leg, and yet you're going to have to start everything on your left. You know, it was very, very impressive to do that.
Even more when we go dancing.
You should hear the roar when we hit the floor. Come on, boys, build a barge. Make it fancy, make it large. Grab an oar, row with style, take us down the Nile.
Alice and Emily had started rehearsals like before any of us, because Bobby wanted to drill the dance numbers and have them, you know, like give them a head start because they had so much material. So by the time the rest of the cast got together, they had already, you know, and I think maybe they did a number for us like the first day. And then I started to get a feeling of like, oh my God, this is amazing.
In our contracts, we had separate dressing rooms. We had our own dressing rooms, but we looked at each other after 8 weeks of rehearsal and said, we have to get ready together at half hour. How can we split? Because the doors close and then you don't see each other again until you get on stage. So we shared a big room, and it was a lot of fun decorating it.
Bobby Longbottom was incredibly focused, and I was really impressed by that. He really knew what he wanted and wasn't allowing anybody to screw around at all, which is sort of what he's known for, but I very much respected what he was doing.
Bobby said to us in early rehearsals, you all, in your own way, are a freak. And we're like, huh? But he said, you all, when you auditioned for me, you all had a vulnerability and some damage that you weren't afraid to bring to the table and kind of show us in the audition. And he said, that made me want to work with. That's why this cast is this cast. I remember a really specific rehearsal. The material was so close to home, going through my divorce, and what I was saying to Alice, it was at the end of the show when I was telling her I can't marry her, and that I love her, but not enough to be with her. And I just remember I started to sing what Henry wrote, and I think like projectile tears. And we literally had to stop rehearsal. I think I went to the bathroom and just like stuck my head in the sink. And they were so loving. And because of that, we were never afraid to be vulnerable or bring all of our baggage to the table. And I remember this so well. Alice said, this is freaking me out. She said, I feel like I'm your ex-wife. It's freaking me out because it's so real. It's so real.
Out of the five principals, I was the only fictional character, Jake. And the other ones were true characters. So I had to build up on something that was kind of based on me. And I decided to just kind of go back into ex-girlfriends and people that have been a part of their lives and put that into being in love with this character and wanting to take care of her. And also having unrequited love and sometimes love from a distance. I've done all that stuff. So I used all of that to bring to this character.
One of these days you will look back in shame after you've learned that a spark's not a flame. You will regret how you push the love aside when you're married to nothing, when your misery's bride. You should be loved by someone who wants you, tries to protect you, always comes through. You should have chosen the one who supports you, always supports you. Whatever you do, yes, you should be loved in the way I love you.
The show only got better in previews.
It did change quite a bit, and I do remember there was one night that an entire lyric changed. I actually had stuff written on my hand because I was like, I can't learn it this fast.
There was a second act number where they were in bed together, except there was a partition that separated them so they could pretend to have a little privacy even though their hip was still joined, so the girls could have their courtship. It was hilarious and unnecessary, but that ended up on the street.
There was a scene where we were shooting a commercial, and Buddy and the girls were in like this big heart, and it was a scene to show that things were starting to bubble, and Daisy and I were not getting along, and she was kind of being a diva, but that was cut.
The one significant song that I remember being cut was it's at the end, and Buddy is asking Violet about getting married, and they're at the wedding already, and you know there's a lot of stuff going on in Violet's mind, and there's a song called She's Gone, and it was very much of kind of like a Barbara Streisand type song, you know, don't tell me not da da da, but it just didn't work because it was taking away from the storyline too much, and so all she had to do was say the word no. And that's all that song was about. No, I'm not going to marry her.
Well, we made lots of cuts. First act was too long, but the first act was great. The beginning of the act with Come Look at the Freaks, ending with Who Will Love Me As I Am, was so tight and made such sense. I mean, it gets everybody's hopes up. Wow, where are they going to go with this? And we had that challenge because if you took the Siamese twins out of the equation, it was a rags to riches boy loves girl and sister, you know, we were shy on plot for the second act, I felt.
The guys worked better in the workshop than they did, I think, in the final production. My ex-wife actually said, I think it's a story about the guys and how they deal with, because that's what we all deal with, right? With whether, you know, to jump ship with somebody or not, based on our fears of our appearances and all that sort of thing. But it had been from the beginning written as a piece about the two girls, and they weren't about to change that.
Some guys wonder how it will work. Some women titter and smirk. Ha 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 ha! All their questions will be resolved. I've got the problem solved. It's 1 + 1. 1 + 1. 1 + 1.
A duo, a twosome who's compact. But we're happy to welcome an addition to our act. He's Violet's intended.
I'm the lucky one.
I'm the one who's lucky.
Ain't we having fun?
We did previews, and so we would do a preview till 11 o'clock at night, and then we would get up at 6, 5 or 6 a.m. and sing on a morning show. Or be interviewed on the radio or whatever. And then we would be back at the theater that same day rehearsing the changes for the preview and do the show at night. And that was a constant thing. So it was a full-time intense regime. So I just remember drinking a lot of energy drinks. A lot of energy drinks, a lot of coffee.
It was not easy to do. There are shows that are easy, I think. Depends on a lot of different things. But it was always worth the investment of my time and energy. I never felt drained by it.
They were huge, the size of these roles and the expectations and the vocal demands and the costume changes and wig changes and just being able to come in out of your day, put all of that away somehow and know that you have to surrender a part of you to this other person and cooperate on a level that I've never seen in a Broadway musical.
I do remember a few weeks into the run looking at Emily and saying, wow, are we going to be able to do this for a whole year? This is intense work.
They were both, I think they challenged each other as actresses, and the bar went higher and higher, and Bobby encouraged them in all the right ways, and it became, you know, we knew we had something very special.
It's a big thing, that show. I mean, Henry wrote it. It's a big thing. It's big emotionally. It's a big sort of big arc. You're on stage all of the time. If you're not, you're doing miraculously fast, intricately choreographed, full costume changes. To me, the element of that show that was difficult was just the stamina. The stamina to do it 8 times a week. And to sing it in a way that, I think if nothing else, both Alice and I left our blood and guts on the floor in the way we sang that show.
Really wasn't about Siamese twins, but it was about those two blondes, and they sang the hell out of it. I will never leave you. Whoa. Yeah, it was good.
We were all exhausted, and I think we had done a matinee, and Alice was belting like G's and F sharps, like crazy, crazy high belt. And one night, I remember she went into her soprano. She didn't belt it that night. And I came off stage and I was like, what was that? I thought Julie Andrews was here. And she's like, fuck you. I will belt that from now on, even if I'm exhausted, just to say fuck you. And she did. She never did it soprano again.
Alice, Emily, and Hugh Panaro would always compete with each other to see who would hit higher notes. Alice won that, but Emily and Hugh Panaro were kind of toeing neck and neck. They wouldn't change the melody or anything like that, but they would just try to see who would get the highest note or the more intense note. So that was always fun.
Emily some nights would riff, and she would riff the line right before mine. So I would always match her. So whatever riff she did, I would try to do it. So she did, Terry is on fire. I would go, I can't even try. And then she'd change it up. And I would try to match it every night. And then one night, Henry came back and said, Hugh, don't encourage her. So we had to rein it in a little bit.
Some people were a little more vulnerable than others as far as getting sick. And I remember, I think that there's a tape of me floating around where I couldn't finish my line. And I just went, Violet! I had to make up something because the music was still playing.
Our audiences were wonderful. I think people came going, oh, this will be interesting. And at the end of the show, they had really gone on a journey and were compelled by that and affected by that. And that's the best kind of theater there is. That's theater. That's successful theater to me. And people at the stage door would say, we didn't know what this was going to be, and we've already bought tickets for next week, you know?
It looked like a sideshow. Short, fat, tall, skinny, all shapes and sizes and colors and configurations of humanity. They were waiting for us, and they became the audience that's made the show what it is. They call themselves freaks.
It was so obvious the show was working when we had the people there. It was just getting them there was proving to be so daunting.
The sadness of Sideshow was just that we opened in a season with Lion King and Ragtime and Scarlet Pimpernel, and you know we didn't have a massively capitalized budget so that we could sustain to build an audience.
We got as good reviews as I think any of us could have hoped for.
And you look back at the reviews, it was a successful thing. I think. I mean, I didn't read all of them, but certainly Ben Brantley's was pretty much all thumbs up, you know?
We needed a rave from the Times. Somebody in the Times who said, you have to go. But that didn't happen. It was polite.
I think our biggest problem was the word Siamese twins. And even if you came and you cried and you got it, when you told your neighbor, Siamese Twins, you went right to Jerry Springer. We didn't have a TV commercial, which I think might have helped show the audience that this isn't distasteful and that is but a metaphor.
Even 17 years ago, you needed to think out of the box. I remember Scarlet Pimpernel, they put a demo CD in the New York Times. Everybody that got a New York Times got a free CD. They were on milk cartons. They were on taxi cabs. They were doing the work. We got like the best reviews of the season, and yet no one even knew we existed.
People were like gaga over it. And it was mostly, unfortunately, the word of mouth in the community. The tourists didn't know anything about the show. And unfortunately, the marketing, our poster, our front of the theater just didn't appeal to anybody. And no one was curious about it. So we started seeing our audience lessen and lessen.
We didn't have any photos outside our theater. We didn't have anything. People didn't know what it was about. They were going with this whole like mystique. And I remember it wasn't very popular, but I remember I took our press rep out across the street and I said, look at that theater. Are you trying to close the show?
I do remember very distinctly about 3 years into writing the project, Manny came up to me and said, Bill, you realize that just the idea of conjoined twins really repels a lot of people. And I went, what? Really? To me, it was just fascinating. I really had no idea that a lot of people, you say conjoined twins or freaks or sideshows, and they're just like, oh no, I don't want to go there. It wasn't until we opened and we weren't selling that it was clear we were just barely making our nut, that then it became anxiety provoking.
We would come out, because there was no curtain, we would walk out, sit on the bleachers, and look out in the audience. And the Richard Rogers, you know, it has a section on both sides and then the middle section. And the top section was just basically closed off. There was no one there. And the middle, the two sides, we would see smatterings of people. So the ushers would make people sit in that middle section to kind of give us a denser audience looking. And you know, by the end of that run, finally, you know, the last week, people were like, oh, the final show. So they started coming then. But gosh.
It ran 11 weeks. There was no more money, and we had one winning week, the closing week. Everything else was losing, and it was inexplicable. We didn't know what to do. We advertised, we spent the money, and then you face, you know, the tough part in the of the season for the theater is the winter, January, February, March, and then we had no advance, and you just couldn't take any more losses.
Alice and Emily did up their dressing room big time, spent a whole lot of money. And I'd done Smile back in 1985, and we were all absolutely sure it was a hit. And I spent all this money, and we all spent all this money, and then it folded and went down in flames. So I went to Alice and Emily, I said, you guys really should wait. And they were like, don't be Captain Bring Down here. That's so negative of you, you know. And so when we shut down finally in January, whenever that was, Alice, I think it was, came and apologized to me. She said, you're right, this business is rough, you know.
When we buy the couch, that means that the show's gonna run, right? And so we bought the couch, I remember. It was a leopard print, pull-out, hide-a-bed couch. Really, really cute. But that was it. As soon as we bought the couch, that was it. That was the end of the show. I guess it's kind of like jumping the shark.
When we were trying to sell tickets, and you know the ticket booth on 47th Street, well, Alice was there peddling, talking to people on the line.
It just felt like a natural progression to me. The next thing you do is go out, and like, if not enough people know about what you're doing and you know it's worth seeing, you go out yourself and just start telling people. So I became a missionary for the show.
Alice, Emily, Norm, and I, among others, were out there in the freezing cold begging people to come see Sideshow.
Back then, the line at the tickets booth was divided into two groups, people that were going to see Cats and people that weren't going to see Cats. And the people that were going to see Cats, you just let them go, didn't try to talk them out of it. But everybody else, I could kind of get them to come to the show, and I did.
I will never forget this as long as I live. We handed a lady a flyer, and she said, oh, I'm sorry, I already bought tickets to see Cats. And we went, oh my God, have you never seen Cats? And she said, oh no, I've seen it like 10 times. I come to New York, I see Cats every single year. And we were like, well, maybe tonight you're lucking it. Why don't you come see something new? And she stared at us with this like icy stare and said, I like Cats. And I thought, this is what we're up against.
In my lowest moments, I said, well, it's a freak show. And I put myself out there, and that this is the reaction to it. That was the lowest, you know? But I also knew we had done something meaningful and worthwhile, but it was a heartbreak.
I have a recollection of what the closing night was. The cast walked out and got a 12-minute ovation before they said anything, standing up.
Stomping and clapping. And it was unbelievable. It's like, how can this be closing?
There was so much emotion about the fact we were closing, and the song Say Goodbye to the Freak Show. There was audible sobs all over the house. And
it was over capacity. They let everybody in. there were so many, too many people in the house.
It felt like the end of an era, but it also felt like the beginning of something. I knew back then that the show was going to have its time, because it really didn't have its time, but I knew that it would.
There was a period of time when they were going to bring it back. And it was tricky because I had already said yes to Hal Prince to do Showboat in London. And I was, you know, kind of trying to tread water and not sign my contract, because I thought if Sideshow is brought back, I'm not going to miss it.
I had just been hired right after that to go do the national tour of Ragtime. And we went back to live entertainment to let them know that if they raise enough money to bring the show back, I'm going to go back to Sideshow, because that I felt like that was my show. And they said they had the money, but a week or so after they said they had the money, they didn't have the money.
There was that hope, and yeah, but once that fell apart and everything, it definitely took a while to get over it.
On one hand, being totally candid, I will say that when January happened, there was a part of me that first week after it closed that I was grateful for the recovery time, because it was a hard, hard thing. But it was very, very, very hard.
It took a year of banging my head against the wall. I didn't understand why something that was such an audience pleaser and had made me so happy would be forced to close. But after a while, I accepted it. And then we wrote some other things. Because yeah. Michael Bennett always said to me, as soon as you are about to finish one thing, always have something else in your pocket. And keep doing what you do, keep doing what you do. Otherwise, it won't be good.
It took a couple of years to pay off all the bills, at least for me and a few others. But no regret about having your name on that show.
Sony Records made our album for us. And I'm convinced that that's the reason why the show has an audience. Because for a long time, kids have been handing me this album and saying, this is my favorite show. And they say, I've never seen it, but
without that, I don't know that show would have had a life, you know? That's why when things close without having a cast album, I go, oh, it's kind of important.
Thank God that album got made, yeah. Both Emily and I were both very vulnerable, our voices, on that day. So we were lucky and happy that the quality of it is good.
I remember when we got Tony nominated, I remember getting that phone call and being astounded by that, being absolutely astounded. Because as you know, the Tonys are kind of political, and there was no gain to be had. There was no gain to be gotten by nominating us. The show wasn't running. The show hadn't run for 5-6 months. So that was sort of amazing, I think.
I was thrilled. I was so happy, excited, proud. Yeah, and enthusiastic about sharing Violet with everybody else, because I felt like the Tony committee recognizing us gave life to the show.
It was a little surreal months and months later putting that back on and going, oh, okay. But I'm glad we did it and glad it was out there, and it was a big emotional night.
I remember being at the Tonys and putting on her costume again, and how I wanted to be alone. I want to be alone. I wanted everybody to go away so I could spend some time with Violet before we went out and talk to everybody, because Violet's shy. I was really nervous because I had seen Natasha Richardson in Cabaret. I knew she was going to win. That isn't why I was nervous. I was just nervous to perform in front of everybody. Radio City is really big. But then once we got started, I felt that thing again that I feel when I sing with Emily and we do that score. It felt so natural. It felt like we were flying together, and that's what we're supposed to do.
I just remember being tremendously moved standing there.
Beside you is where I will stay. Evermore and always, we'll be one though we're two. The day is filled with shadows that stretch into the night. I am filled with your sweet comfort, like morning fills with light. I will never leave you. I will never go away. We were meant to share each moment. Beside you is where I.
Students ask me about my favorite shows, and you know, there are a lot of shows. And I never expect them to know when I say, well, it was this show, Sideshow. And they know about it. Young people know about the show. So it has a resonance.
I feel like every week I'll meet somebody who's like, oh, I just found this cast album. I just found this, my God. Or they'll say, I was at your final show. Or they'll say, you know, my high school did Sideshow. It's amazing. On a constant basis, I'm still connected to that show, and I sort of love it that it's a thing that's out in the world and hopefully will be out there for a long, long time.
I think we're all proud of it. I'm proud of it. If you ask me, were you the producer of it? Yeah. Yeah. And was it better than a lot of other shows? Yeah. Is it still better? Yeah. It bothers me. It bothers me that it wasn't successful.
And there's a line that Violet sings right before Who Will Love Me As I Am, and it says, but I want to wake up to what I'm dreaming of, dreaming that someday, some night, I could find love. Will I find love? That sums up how I feel about the show. There's always one line from the show for me, and I don't realize what it is until much later. Next to Normal has its own line, you know, but for Sideshow, it's that one.
It was all a great, one of those rare shows in which it was a family affair.
The connections are insane. I ran into Alice the other day on the street, and people must have thought we were crazy people. We just like hugged and cried and held on to each other for like, you know, 10 minutes.
It was like a love fest. We all were card-carrying freaks, every one of us. Even the ones that didn't look like them were. And we all celebrated that.
It's as if we've all shared summer camp or a concentration camp, depending upon the way you want to look at it.
Every day I'm grateful to be a part of something that has really affected people and continues to affect people. And we're grateful for every single performance that we got to do. Every single performance.
Once you fall in love with that show, you fall in love with it. We listen to the music once a year. It's a kind of a ritual, and everybody cries.
I think it's just a massively human. It's just a massively human story. I think everybody at some point in their life has felt like an outsider, has felt like a freak, you know? And that's what this is about. And for me, the story of the Hilton sisters that was told in that piece is about self-acceptance. Is about how sometimes the people who we perceive as freaks have to be the most well-adjusted, have to be the most sort of self-actualized in their ability to exist in the world. And there's something amazing about that.
Who will love me as I am? I mean, how much more personal can you get? I think we all relate to that. No matter how we look or feel, we look and all that, it's a potent theme.
It's got a soul by itself. It's not limited to, with all due respect to Alice and Emily. This is about who will love me as I am, and loyalties, and I will never leave you, and you should be loved by someone who needs you. I mean, how much more romantic are you going to get? It was Shameless.
It just means so much to people, and it means so much to us. I sit there, I mean, I've heard this material a lot, but sometimes I'm just able to sort of react to it afresh.
In the moment, yeah.
And it just kills me.
Yeah, I love that I was in the show that haunts people. It haunts people.